The following message by Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark is brought to you by Full Stature Ministries and its supporters. For more information about Full Stature Ministries, please visit forgive123.com. That's forgive123.com.
No baby food this morning, all right? And this is for something that you're not going to be able to do a pray after me prayer and get it, all right? I know we like that, and traditionally in the church, we have, after every course, we have a pray after me prayer, and people go, okay, and I ask Jesus to do this and that. We don't do, not us. No, no. We give you the pray after me prayer that you take home, meditate on it for about a week or two. All right, and that's what we're going to talk about today. Literally having something written on the tablet of the heart. We read that, but do we really have it? I believe that we know more Bible than we know experientially. Do you believe that? That you know more Bible than you know experientially. And so I want to take it really to the school of the Spirit this morning and how God basically taught me to make something personal. You know, we say personalize the scriptures, internalize it. But I believe that there's an inworking and an outworking. And today's message is how to receive in order to overflow. How to receive in order to overflow. The how-to is absolutely essential. Because I believe that what God is saying is that he's going to grant you, just like the Apostle Paul's prayer, according to the riches of his glory, that you might be strengthened by his Spirit in the inner man. Ephesians 3, verses 16 to 20. That he would grant you, according to that riches, that you would be strengthened with might through his Spirit in the inner man. This is where Messiah may dwell in your hearts through faith, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend what is the width, the length, the depth, and the height of the love of God. That you might really come to know practically through experience for yourself the love of Messiah, which far surpasses mere knowledge without experience. Let's stop right there. Which surpasses mere knowledge without experience. You can have a lot of biblical knowledge that's in the head, that you are still lacking that supernatural experience of owning it. It is not written on the tablet of the heart because you read it. What someone told me this week, when I told them that repetition is necessary in teaching, because a lot of times we're not educating the church, we're re-educating the church. When you re-educate, you need to say it several times so that they break the one paradigm of understanding and bring it into an openness to a new paradigm. So the inworking and the outworking, and these are literally the two words that God gave me over a period of time, when he was beginning to show me really what we could call hidden with Christ in God. That could also be a nice subtitle. What does it mean to be hidden with Christ in God? But how to receive in order to overflow. You can only give something you've received, and you can only receive something that you're open to in the first place. There's a mouthful in there. Think about it, because this pertains to real spiritual knowledge. You can only overflow or give what you've received, but you can only receive what you're open to in the first place. And so what God basically did with me is he showed me what open meant. How to be open to God, open to life, open to people. That spiritual openness was a prerequisite for receiving. And so he basically said that I want you to practically know through experience for yourselves the love of God, which surpasses mere knowledge. Now, I told this on one of the TV programs that we did recently, the quick version. Those are 20-some minute programs, so I have to do the quick version. Well, I'm going to stretch it out a little bit today because I'm not restricted by time. But I want to tell a story of when I was looking at this portion of Scripture about the height, the width, the length, and the depth of the love of God, I was familiarizing myself with the fact that it's height, width, length, depth, the love of God. And then in Revelations, you know that he says, this is the new Jerusalem that comes down from heaven? That's my bride. And it's shaped as a cube. Isn't that interesting? So then I looked at Ephesians, said the height, the width, the length, and the depth. Well, God wants us to be a cube. To really know the love of God, we should be shaped like a cube. You didn't know you were going to be called a square today. No, you're going to be called worse than a square. You're a cube. And you need to be a cube. So I'm in prayer when God's revealing this to me. And at that point in my life, I still compartmentalized, unfortunately. And everything to me was the spiritual life, and I hated everything that didn't pertain to the spiritual life, like yard work. All right? Cutting the grass, taking the garbage out. But anyway, God basically showed me, and even as a very young pastor, as a young Christian, really, I was teased by my fellow pastors. And one of the ways they would tease me is they say, Dennis has enough vision that if you don't have a vision, he'll impose his on you. All right? And I had a vision for everything. I had domes and pillars. I had this and I had that and I had these pictures and that pictures. And one time they were establishing an apostolic network, and Dr. Bez was there. And they said, well, what are we going to call this network? And somebody says, Antioch. And they were, well, we need to get a picture of this. So they drew us. So I wrote a circle on the board. And they go, no. Dennis has got the dome now. He's going to insert his dome revelation on our by giving a circle. And so they were always messing with me. So when I'm in prayer with God, God's basically, I'm looking at the height, the width, the length. I'm looking at the length, and I'm going, oh, God, your desire was that Christ be formed in me was the internal vision. But the external vision, oh, that I would just do whatever he told me to do, and I've got all of these things that he's laid on my heart to do and all these things that I want to do in the future. Oh, the length of my building was long. I had one long building. And then I had a prayer life, and I used to basically feel that I had a really good prayer life, even as a baby Christian. So I'm going, oh, yes, and I'm a worshiper, and I pray. Oh, yes, my building is high. I saw the height. I saw the length. And then I saw from the time I was a baby Christian, there were people that would come to me for ministry. So I said, that's because I've got victory. You don't go to somebody that doesn't have victory. You don't go to a depressed person and say, pray for me, do you? Okay. So even as a baby Christian, I had people always come into my house. So I says, that's because there's depth, and I've got victory over the devil. I trample him under my foot. And so while I'm exalting in all of this revelation about the length and the height and the depth of the building, God says, what does your building look like? I thought, my goodness, I said, it's really long, really high, and it's really deep. And he goes, it's really skinny. And I'm like, oh, it's a skinny building. Mm-hmm. And it can be knocked over by the wind, the slightest wind. I was insulted. And then I kind of got what he was saying. You've so spiritualized that everything is spiritual. It's vision for the future. Oh, that I was not disobedient to the heavenly vision, and I wasn't. Oh, that I had a prayer life and a worship life that was high. Oh, I had victory over the devil, and that was deep. But I had not taken the ability to get God into the everyday mundane parts of life. And he showed me in my mind's eye cutting the grass. I mean, they got killed in the wilderness for that same attitude. I mean, really, complaining and murmuring? I mean, get you killed. And I'm over here, I'm going to do this grass, and I got time for this. I should be praying and studying and doing spiritual stuff. I shouldn't be cutting grass, you know. Anybody else do this? Am I the only one that's ever did this? Okay. And God was basically trying to reveal to me, he says, you know, you're not a cube. You're a skinny sheet. Very high, very deep, very long, but skinny nonetheless. Because really what he wanted me to learn was the height, the width, the length, and the depth of the love of God by experience. And if it was going to be experience, I had to bring them into the things that I hated, or the things that I thought I hated, or the things that I thought were not spiritual, even indifferent. And I basically took that to heart, and I allowed him to do the inner working, and I took all of the things that I didn't like to do. And you know, the day came when God showed me that where he had first started this work and I had lost sight of it was shortly after my conversion. I had gotten off of drugs, off of welfare, and I took a job in a trucking firm that paid less than welfare. And I begged for that job 3 times. And they told me no when I was relieved the first time. They told me no, I was relieved the second time. And the third time they hired me. And the reason the guy hired me, he said, I've been running this trucking firm for 40 years. I've never had anybody in the last 40 years ask for the same job 3 times. I'm hiring simply because of the tenacity of your request. And guess what my job was that after I begged for this job? I got to clean the restrooms. There was, I think, 4 or 5 restrooms in the whole facility. And my job was to clean the restrooms. But here's what I learned back then that I had lost sight of. That while I was cleaning those restrooms, I would literally, and it wasn't from the Clorox, I would literally get intoxicated with the joy of the Lord. That I was doing it, and this is an important truth, I was not doing it unto man, I was doing it unto the Lord, that he sent me there. I knew he sent me there, and that's why I kept going back, because he kept telling me to go back. So I'm saying, God has appointed the exact time and the exact place in which we should live. If we would move in obedience to that, regardless of the external, and treat it as he is your boss, not man, it changes something on the inside. And I was cleaning those toilets, feeling the joy of the Lord, and it, because I was doing it for God, not for man. And within days, he says, can you do payroll? And I said, yeah. Can you do this? Yeah. Can you do that? Yeah. Within a few days, rather than paying his people overtime, he created a job out of the overflow of all the office workers. And I had my own desk within days. From cleaning the toilets and mopping the muddy floor where the truckers would come in to dispatch. But God showed me that truth and how I had lost sight of that truth later on in my walk with the Lord. And he says, until you can bring that attitude back into cutting the grass and doing that kind of stuff, he says, you are not walking in the height, the width, the length, and the depth of the love of God. My bride is going to be balanced. My bride is going to have the love of God experientially in all of those areas. Well, over a period of time and practice, days and weeks, I internalized that and welcomed the rule of God in those areas. And yes, you do have to enter into peace, because joy is nothing more than the love of God rejoicing. Peace is nothing more than the love of God resting. And it's all love, and it's all the nature of God. However, we're at a crucial time. And this is why I want to give this message. We're at a time where I'm looking at our young people, and there's a diversion that they're coming from in the body of Christ, and that God is love, but love is not God. I'm watching people call it love at the expense of righteousness. I'm sorry, that's not God. Love at the expense of righteousness is not the love of God. And we've got this love, love, love mentality that is failing to identify the anointing of holiness and love must combine to be true. Holiness is basically something that promotes distance. Love is promoting relationship and closeness. As God cleanses our heart and we get clean before him, the holiness and the love fuse together. And the next move of God is going to be a revelation of the Father. I don't doubt that whatsoever. But we've seen the Father's love in the days of Toronto and during that important. And it's a significant move of God. But the holiness aspect has to be entered in, or you don't truly know the Father. The Father wants love and the holiness to be two anointings that come together to be ministered effectively. And then we'll be able to keep the ground that God gives us to move in the power gifts and the signs and the wonders. You're going to have the stability that can be counted on in the days ahead. So Having said all of that, God is love, but love is not God. How many of you know what I'm talking about now? Not at the expense of righteousness. When love is at the expense of righteousness, that's not God. All right? But there is almost a hippie movement in the church. I call it hippie movement. I'm old enough to remember what that was like. All right? Not that I was one, but the boss that I worked for wore a headband, had one earring in his ear, and that was standard procedure in my day. All right? But God is looking for that beautiful blend of two bottles of wine, the wine of his love and the wine of holiness. And when the two are fused together, it's going to complement and reveal the heart of the Father. Father disciplines those he loves. But all the love of heaven is even behind the discipline, or it's not God. So we're going to pray. We're going to show you the step-by-step place of making God that hiding place, that significant place where he's going to preserve you from the trouble that's coming in the days ahead. Because darkness, gross darkness, will cover the earth, but arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is going to rise upon it. So God's going to do something here, and I really believe he's going to teach you how to be his hiding place. In a not hiding in fear, but hiding in security, safety, and family. God's going to teach us that by his Spirit, the family of God. It's in Psalm 32, verses 7 and 8. It says, "You are my hiding place. You will preserve me from trouble. You will surround me with songs of deliverance." And God says, "I will instruct you and teach you in the way that you shall go, and I will guide you with my eye." What's beautiful about that is that teach, that word teach, in the original language actually means to direct the flow. I will guide you with my eye. I will direct the flow. I mean, I knew as a young preacher, there was times I'd start preaching and then you would just feel the river was moving in a different direction. You learn to yield to that flow. God will direct the flow in your life. He will direct the path before you when he's ruling like that. But this hiding place is not something that hides from the world. It's not an ostrich sticking its head in the sand. It's basically preserving you from trouble, meaning with songs of deliverance, I will teach you in a way you shall go. In other words, in the midst of the darkness, arise, shine, for a light is come. That's always been the strategy of God from the beginning. From the beginning, in Gideon hiding away, they were hiding away the wrong way, trying to etch out a living, running from the Midianites, hiding from the Midianites. And then what did he say? He basically said, here's the strategy. The strategy is that you shall put the torches in the clay pots. We're like a clay pot. Put that torch in there, and then when that clay pot is broken, that light's going to shine in the midst of darkness and confuse the enemy for a change. And see, when you're in that secret place of the Most High, the trouble can't touch you. Peace, when it guards your heart and your mind, it's the most militant part of the kingdom of God. Peace is militant. Peace is not passive. The rest we're talking about is a rest of safety, because when peace guards your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus, the evil one can't touch you. If peace guard, it either guards your heart or it doesn't guard your heart. It's either supernatural or it's not supernatural. But peace is not passive. Peace is militant. And the God of peace will crush the enemy beneath your feet. But light shined in darkness. And I loved it. 600 years before Jesus came on the scene, in Isaiah 9, it says, "A people who sit in darkness shall see a great light, and the rod of the oppressor shall be broken as in the day of Midian." So it referred to Gideon and his battle, that the coming Messiah is going to come, and when he comes on the scene, a light's going to shine in the midst of darkness, but the rod of the oppressor is going to be broken as in the day of Midian. And God's saying, "And now, arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you." God's waiting for his people to be like torches, to crack open that clay vessel, brokenness in a good way. I've heard in the body of Christ, people use that word brokenness two different ways. Sometimes they mean it in a bad way, and other times it's a good way. I only know it in a good way. Broken to me in a good way is that the shell of that flesh, that veil, has been removed, and the anointing can flow out. It was easy to get him in. It's a little more getting him out. All right? Now I'm going to mess with you, and I'm going to show you can't do this with a pray after me prayer. All right? But we're going to become God's hidden ones, aren't we? We're going to be the ones that are hiding in the secret place of the Most High, abiding under the shadow of the Almighty so that nothing can touch us or harm us. Because we're going to have it all around us. Evil will be all around us, darkness all around us, but darkness can't swallow up light. So if we let that light shine, this little light of mine, if I let it shine, you actually conquer. Huh? So there's two stages. The first stage is understanding this, that we're living in a time when you cannot hold judgments, that the blood of forgiveness is going to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And one of the things that he taught me early on, to practice the presence of God will require a forgiveness lifestyle. But in this forgiveness lifestyle, this does not mean that you love sin. It simply means just the opposite. You welcome the cleansing of sin in your own heart, toward God, toward yourself, and toward other people. When that becomes a lifestyle, you walk in the light as he is in the light. All right? And we are what? Children of light from the Father of lights. All right? So that's the first stage. Yeah, if we've been united together in his likeness, then certainly Messiah's death certainly shall be in the likeness of that resurrection that comes forth. Our old man was crucified. The body of sin was done away with. And we should no longer be slaves to sin, but he who has died has freed us from sin. That's step one. Now I want to get into the outflow. The second part is the death to the sin nature brings us to the place where the cross works in our life. But the outflow of divine life comes to the conformity to the death, learning what it means to be hidden in God. And here's what I see for a generation of people. This is not a popular teaching, because church as usual, we really want something a little more superficial and make us feel good. All right, this might not make you feel good, but this is supposed to challenge you. And without challenge, you don't change. You stay the same. But it basically, here's the goal for Kingdom Life Church, Full Stature Ministries, and everything we do. 2 Corinthians 4. And if you're a note taker, I would write this one down if you write nothing else down. Because for we who live are always delivered to death for Jesus' sake, so that, this is the reason that says that, so that the life of Jesus might be made manifested in our mortal flesh. And why do we care? Because so then, death is working in us, but life is working in you. The only person when I was growing up that I felt I identified with was Wade Taylor, because he was concerned about the outflow of substance, not information. I am weary of the outflow of information. Even prophetic information is not revelation until it's you own it. I want revelation that brings transformation, not revelation for information. And you can move in both. I want the information to become transforming, and so that if death to my flesh works in me, then the outflow is life to other people, substance, something that they could close their eyes. Instead of taking notes and just learning the information for their head, they can open their heart. And you know what? As a young pastor, I used to get excited when I would occasionally see some people sleeping during my sermons, because not all of them were sleeping. You know what some of them were doing? They were opening their heart and drinking in substance that God was writing on the tablet of their heart that your intellect will never, never appreciate fully. The intellect only can go so far, but the heart can have stuff written on it by the finger of God. I wanted to produce living epistles that carried it with them, written on the tablet of their heart. So if that is the case, then I don't want just wishful thinking. I want hidden ones. I want us to have died and that our life is hidden in Messiah Jesus. Our life is hidden in him. Now, if we are hidden, by the way, hidden is a good place. I just was looking at the word hidden, just looking up the word hidden, and it says, you know, that I've been crucified with Messiah. It is no longer I that live, but Messiah that lives in me. That's one of my favorite scriptures. It's no longer I that live, but Christ that lives within me. I saw that not only you kind of are what you eat. All right. Well, if you feast upon him at the final place to where it becomes reality, and it's you become a partaker of the divine nature, and it's written on the tablet of your heart. Guess what? At that point, it's still me eating and drinking. It's me receiving the divine nature. But after I receive the divine nature, there's something of me that gets swallowed up by him. And therefore, the outflow is him living his life through me, not me living for God. Isn't that beautiful? That's Galatians 2:20. So you are what you eat, but eventually God wants to devour us. He wants to feast on, give him more of yourself, and he'll gladly replace it with resurrection life. It may be producing death to your flesh, but it's producing life in the hearers and the people around you. It produces death in you, but life in others. We need to start being life givers instead of information givers. And there's a lot of flowery language that I saw that the early mystics had, and I think a lot of people got turned off at the flowery language, but in reality, they were struggling to explain deep, rich, intimate relationship with God, and they didn't have words for a subjective experience, so they did the best they could, and it probably sounded flowery, but guess what? For most of them, it was a real thing. It wasn't information. They were trying to describe an internal relationship of no-so. And when I required that kind of same kind of no-so, God took me into a season to where I kept documenting. Now, when I say document, everybody loves the word technique, method, all right? But for me, it was a relationship. But you know what? To instruct Jennifer when she said disciple me, I needed to put it in a logical pattern, kind of like our tracks. Everybody wants people saved supernaturally. But don't some people need us tracked? A, ask Jesus, did you? B, believe that you received? C, confess? That's just the way we're wired mentally. So, God started working on Dennis to make him move into the width so that he was a square. He didn't want to be cool no more. He wanted to be a square. He wanted to be a cube, just like the bride, just like the new Jerusalem that comes out of heaven. The height, the width, the length, and the depth of the love of God. God wants you balanced. So here's what he did. He started, and I started writing down from the initial encounter. That means any word God quickens. How many have had words quickened you out of the scriptures? Okay, I'm going to show you what he told me to do when he quickened the word. I didn't just go, ooh, ah, I think I'll tell everybody that one. He wouldn't let me do that. You know what he did? Can we have that that overhead? Because this will make it easier. Can we do that PowerPoint? And if you're on the camera lady, if you can, there's something worth writing down and going slow with. The next time God quickens a word, this is the way he taught me to do it. Number one, there is both the inworking. Didn't we say that death works in you so that life might work in other people? The next time you get a verse quickened, don't just spew it out in 2 seconds. It doesn't mean you own it. It doesn't even mean you know it experientially. But what God had me do was, number one, start off in the natural with a choice. What does a choice mean? Do you have a prayer life? That means, will you honor me by taking your physical body and plopping down somewhere? And step number one, honor me with a prayer life. If you can't do that, don't expect to move in a lot of revelation. That's just plain old discipline, right? Just making a simple decision. Choose. Choose this day who you will serve. As far as me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord, all right? So there's the choice. Then what he did was, when he would quicken a verse, because I was a talker, he had to teach me to shut up. Because he would quicken a verse to me, like, out of your belly will flow rivers. And then I would go, and there's a river that makes glad the city of God. My head would go, and then I'd get the concordance, and then I'd get, and he'd say, quiet. There's a river, out of my belly flows a river. He says, stay there and absorb it in your heart. Quit telling me what you know. And that was hard for a talker to be still. And basically what he was saying is, there's a river that makes glad. He didn't want to hear that. He didn't want my sermon. He wanted me to hold John 7:38, out of my belly flows river. He said, you hold it there and let me inform your head, but you hold it until you get something from me. In other words, I want you to meet the author of that word. Jesus and his word are one. In the beginning was the word was with God, the word was God. He says, you don't know that the word is God yet. I quickened it to you. I put my resurrection life on it. Now you have a responsibility to absorb it. My word used to be cherish, but when I was discipling Jennifer, she said, what you're doing is absorbing. You're assimilating. You're personalizing it. Yeah. I am welcoming it for God. And if God gives you a word, trust me, there's something in you that needed that word. He didn't do it haphazardly. He's like a good lawyer, a good advocate. He knows exactly what you need, and when he quickens something to you, trust me, you need that. But in that need, he isn't appealing to your head. He wasn't asking you for an opinion. He was saying that if you will absorb this, I will birth a new attitude in you. And trust me, I wouldn't give you this word if you didn't need an attitude adjustment. And when I talk about attitude, I'm not talking mental attitude. I'm talking about a disposition of the heart. I'm talking about the attitude of the heart. And what he showed me in that step, and I was reluctant, was he saying, what you're reluctant is you're trying to wiggle out of the work of the cross. You would rather go for information. You would rather go to a prophetic picture. You would rather, right? I've watched people do this. I prayed with a pastor once that basically said, I've been pastoring for 40 years, but I have this issue with my dad. And every time I think of my dad, there's a wall. And so then what did he do prophetically? He says, Dennis, pray with me. I said, okay. So I pray with him. And he goes, I see a wall with water behind it, and it needs to break through. Ah, that's not the cross. That was a prophetic symbol of what needed to take place. That is not the cross. See, prophecy can stimulate, but it's not the cross. So I says, okay, that's nice. And I'm glad that the breakthrough of the water through that wall made you feel better. But you barely changed the subject. You did not apply death, burial, and resurrection. You went from an unpleasant thought to a pleasant thought. That is not the cross. You stay down there, and now, okay, now, no prophetic pictures right now. We'll save that for when you're having fun. Let's do the cross. Real person now. No eagles, no dragons, real person. Who's the person? My dad. Oh, now we've got something. My dad. Oh, there's a wall down there in your heart. Let Jesus, the forgiver. Jesus is the forgiver, not a principle of forgiveness. He is the forgiver. Let him go to that wall. Let him do like Corrie ten Boom said. Let him do what you can't do. He's the one that forgives sin. Let him go to that wall and through that wall. Now, that's death, burial, and resurrection. I see my Father here, but I feel the supernatural peace of God here. He went up to Kentucky, emailed me back the very next day, and said, in all these years, it was the first time my Father and I had no wall between us. It was a supernatural exchange. That is what God wants. And that's when God speaks to you what he wants from you. He doesn't want you to just repeat it or tell us everything you know about it. He's not impressed with our intellects. He really isn't. He's not impressed with how much reference material you can look up. He says, oh, that's nice. But I want an attitude adjustment. And the only attitude is that death has to work in you, that life becomes something you own. So then he showed me that he was birthing an attitude. And an attitude is a repentance and a forgiveness lifestyle. All right? And whatever scripture he quickens to you, he's trying to birth a new attitude. There's apparently something in your overall mindset that is contrary to that word, or he wouldn't have quickened it to you. He's not just there to kind of interest you. Or by the way, he has a very specific intention when he gives you a word. Now, what most of you should do, if you're watching by Ustream, what you should do is look in the front of your Bible where you wrote your favorite scriptures. Because he knows you. He knit you together in your mother's womb. Your favorite scriptures need this. He knows you well enough that he gave you those so-called favorite scriptures because he knows your tendency to do other than that. I would have been a professional student. I would have stayed in school. And I'd have been learning and learning and never coming to a knowledge of the truth. And God wouldn't let me go to the school I wanted to go to. He said, I'm going to take you to the school of the Spirit. And I'm glad to this day. Because what he taught me there was unlike what I would have pursued. Attitude. I want to birth a new attitude. And after you birth the new attitude through the death, burial, and resurrection, you become a partaker of that divine nature. That scripture is no longer just scripture. That script, you met the author. And you are a partaker of the divine nature. That means he left a residue of transformation on your heart. And if it's transformation, you have a residue of Jesus. Is Jesus in the Word? Aren't we supposed to be conformed and transformed into the image of him? So what did you do when you became a partaker of that divine nature? You have a little bit of Jesus written on the tablet of your heart. You have a particular aspect. And I've shared this time and time again. You know what my railroad track is? God knew my tendency. And my railroad track scripture, the primary prime directive in my life is that I might know him. I heard you say that this morning. That I might know him, that I might progressively become more intimately acquainted with all the wonders of his personhood. So that the outworking of that resurrection life might take place while I'm still in the body. That's what we're talking about this morning. It's the outflow of real life, the outflow of substance that can actually benefit somebody. We need a transfigured fullness, people who have walked in an experiential knowledge of the love of God, both the holiness and the love nature of God, combined to be revealed to others to be living epistles, true sons and daughters. True sons and daughters are going to resemble as living epistles what they've been taught. All right? So, step number four, I'm still working it in. Gee, I didn't know if you get a scripture quickened, it would take this much. It takes me too long to just tell you about it. Most people wouldn't even spend this long that I'm spending telling you about it. But in prayer, this is the way it works, and this is all we've known. I want to go from the shadow of religion and deadness to substance. And that character, what's the end result of that character? Is now you have the person of Jesus, the author of that scripture. You have a revelation of that particular attribute or character quality of him. And you have him now. And when God fortified this last step for me, he used Hebrews 4, 12, and 13. You know what he said? The word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than a two-edged sword, separates soul from spirit, joints from marrow, and it's a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. And then verse 13, well, what are we talking about in verse 12? The word. Word is quick and powerful. It's living. It's active. But verse 13 says, all things are naked and open to the eyes of him. That word now is a person, and that person now has experiential knowledge on the inside of you that nobody can take that away. It's like two people could say, well, I know Tom Cruise because I saw him in a movie. Someone else says, I know Tom Cruise because we lived in the same house for the rest of our life. That word know has two different meanings, doesn't it? Well, God says, I want that knowing to be step five. I want that knowledge not to be head knowledge, but experiential knowledge. That's the inworking. Then God basically showed me that the neatest part is if you welcome that and cherish it. That was my word, cherish. Jennifer said absorb is better. But I cherished it as if it was gold. Any word that God spoke to me, I didn't need quantity. I needed reality. And reality means that even, he says, Dennis, my thoughts toward you are as numerous as the grains of the sands of the sea. But I just, when I realized how vast that is, I just would take anything he said to me as if he picked this grain of sand out of that entire beach, how significant it must be. How significant, how important, how valuable it must be, how precious it must be. How precious are your thoughts toward me, Lord? That you would take that one grain of sand off that beach, all those thoughts that you have for me, and you say, I'm delivering this one to you today. Do you think that's significant? Do you think we would really honor his personhood if we treated a word that he gives us like that instead of just flippantly speaking forward everything we get? That value system then became a person. It was no longer the word. It was him. But this is the part that I enjoyed, that while I stayed there on that word, God was basically saying, you know what I'm doing, Dennis? You were in working and receiving with meekness the engrafted word, but guess what now? Now I'm teaching you to dine and to feast. I'm teaching you to feed instead of read. I'm teaching you to drink instead of think. Not that thinking and reading is bad, but I'm teaching you to do something in the spiritual realm, to drink instead of think and feed instead of read. But then when I got down there to step five, the inworking, he says, now I'm going to teach you what it is to be hidden in me. Now I'm going to, because you've given me your flesh, I'm going to rule and live my life through you. So then he basically fed on me. Oh, he basically said, now I'm going to, and it was like in Gideon. And Gideon, it says, and the Spirit of the Lord came on Gideon. And I had to rethink my picture, because I was one of those kids that used to tie towels around my neck and jump off furniture. I was a superhero from the time I was a little kid. All right. We used to watch Quaker Oats being shot from guns. And I would fall off the couch and roll on the floor because the cannon of puffed wheat would come out, you know, and hit me. But for me, to put the anointing on was a robe, and you tied it around your neck like a towel and like a superhero. And God actually took my head one day while I'm reading, and he took me to a footnote. You know, God uses footnotes too. And I'm reading, and the Spirit of the Lord came on Gideon. And God went like, I could feel my head go to the bottom of the page. And I look at the bottom of the page, a little footnote. And it says, a more literal translation was, the Spirit of the Lord put on Gideon. And in my mind, going from the swashbuckler with the towel wrapped around his neck like a cape crusader, instead I saw, and the Spirit of the Lord put on Gideon. And I saw Gideon like, I'm just a glove. The Spirit of the Lord's going to do whatever he wants to do. I'm going to cooperate. Isn't that different than the swashbuckler mentality? The difference is a person as opposed to an it. We don't use the Holy Spirit as an it. We don't zap people. We allow him to live his life through us and to flow through us. So I says, that's what took place at the bottom of the inworking. All of a sudden now, I am a vessel where God wants to live his life through me. For it is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. This life I live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself to me. And now I'm living in a new way now, but I'm living out of the substance or out of reality. I'm not living out of no-so in my head. I'm living out of experiential. Then, the outworking. This has got to be in everyday life. And the first thing I saw was you have to maintain that connection, because you can get back in the flesh at any given moment. So how did I maintain that? When I was a young Christian, he taught me that if you confess your sin, he is faithful and just to forgive your sin. And sin separates and breaks the connection. But you can reconnect every time you repent and ask for forgiveness. So as a young Christian, I was going, I can't go to work today because I'm busy for asking for forgiveness. I have bad thoughts all day long. Every time I ask for forgiveness, I get another dirty thought, and then I go, oh, I got to ask for forgiveness. How can anybody get any work done? My mind is corrupted. I need work. But God basically showed that through forgiveness, what I saw was those sessions of asking for forgiveness and repentance got further and further apart, and that he showed me that I am getting stronger by making it a habitual lifestyle to walk continually in repentance and forgiveness and letting that light. And our friend Bill Morford says the weakness in all of our American translations of the Bible is that it should be continuously. We should have that word in every sentence because God meant it to be a flow. Ask, seek, knock means ask continually and keep on asking, seek and keep on seeking, knock and keep on knocking. And that's a weakness in our English translations, but God wanted it to be a flow of life. He didn't want it to be a choppy do's and don'ts. He wanted it to be a relationship to where it's a walk in the Spirit, a movement. So the connection was, there's two ways to stay connected. This is the way I do it anyway. You people that are working in a job situation surrounded by unbelieving people, I don't know about you, but one of the things I always did was, besides forgiveness and asking for forgiveness, and that I did silently between me and my God, anything that came between me, God, and other people. But here's the other one, praying in the Spirit. What does Jude say? It says keeping yourself in the love of God. You want to stay in the love of God and you're surrounded by idiots? Huh? How do you stay normal when you're surrounded by all these heathens? Huh? Pray in the Spirit. It'll at least keep you down in your spirit. Your mind is still working on your job. I don't know about you. I can do both. Can you do both? Can you chew gum and walk at the same time? You should be able to pray in the Spirit and be able to do your job at the same time. All right? And eventually I'm going to get to one of the biggest truths that God ever revealed to me about praying in the Spirit. And that was that the outworking of the fact that God taught me to drop down was you can do it 24/7. No, not if it's a product of your mind, you can't. Because then you're going to, if you just use your mind to control prayer, then you're going to say, I'm going to pray every hour on the hour, da, 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 da. That means you're still in control. But your spirit has the capacity to commune with God even while you're sleeping. So you have the ability to reciprocate. So in this reciprocation, God showed me that through forgiveness and praying in the Spirit, in everyday life, you maintain the connection from what God has spoken in your heart. However, he says, you can check yourself by attitude. We're talking, again, not a mental attitude. We're talking about the disposition of the heart. That when a believer opens their heart, asks Jesus to come in, cleanse me of my sin, and I will live for you and serve you all the days of my life, invariably, a new believer says what? Thank you. Nobody taught them to say that. That was the internal response of gratitude to a supernatural exchange. Therefore, as you received Christ, walk the same way. Your attitude needs to be thanksgiving. When you lose the attitude of thanksgiving, you are no longer walking and practicing the presence of God. You need a word at that point. And God will quicken the word if you go to him. He'll give you a word. But that attitude, remember, in the inworking, you were birthing the attitude. Then it's written on the tablet of your heart. Then it becomes your value system. What that means is it's going to be easier for you to do it than to not do it. If it's a supernatural exchange. It should be easier to do than not to do. Therefore, attitude should not be a problem for any believer because you should be able to drop down to number two, ask for forgiveness, and get your attitude back. Most unnecessary ministry is people who really need an attitude adjustment, and it needs to be from the heart, not the head. It's not they did this and they did that. No, more often than not, you have an attitude in the heart that is actually putting up the wall of division. The solution will be internal. Changing external stuff. Anybody still believe in that old thing about trying to change another person? Good luck. What a waste of time. You don't change anybody without their will. But that attitude is one of thanksgiving. And everything give thanks, for this is the will of God, then you're in the will of God. And the will of God is a river, and it's a flow. Lastly, What is the motivation? There's only one motivation. If it's really coming from God, it's love. And that means you may be admonishing, you may be comforting, you may be encouraging, but love is behind it. That's why we say real discernment always goes for the source of the word, not the word. I don't pay attention to every word that it comes out of a Christian's mouth because I can discern the source of that word. If I don't feel my Jesus on the source of that word, I don't accept it. I don't know about you. A lot of people accept words because it's scriptural. Well, the devil can quote scripture. I want to know if the source has the nature of the love of God on it, because even a corrective word should have all the love of heaven. Right? When we were trained in the prophetic, we were trained to give a corrective word to such a degree that the person would still want to take you out to lunch after. If you can't give a corrective word like that, don't give a corrective word. Right? But it really needs to be given that way in a prophetic setting. Say Jennifer was struggling with trust, and she was kind of moping about can't trust God, which I've not seen that. That's a poor example. But say she was. I would just say, Jennifer, the Spirit of the Lord is saying to you that God says that I am bringing you into a place of more implicit trust, and I have truly taken you by the hand, and I'm going to open your eyes and allow you to see that the direction in which you were walking was not was looking down instead of up. And God's saying, I'm going to cause your eyes to be enlightened, and I'm going to cause you to see the path that I set before you. Technically, that was a corrective word. I'd like to be corrected like that, wouldn't you? Because I heard the promise in it. Because what God showed me by doing this with the Word of God, by the in-working and the out-working, you see that word behavior? That word behavior will always be a solution-oriented, redemptive outlook. Not just an action. I've seen religious people do good actions. But it's basically going to be a perception from your heart. You got to have the eyes of Jesus, you got to have the heart of Jesus. And basically what that's saying is, I'm weary of body language and people calling it discernment. Anybody can study facial expressions, body language, and come to a conclusion. You know what that is? It's like an armpit. It's an opinion, and everybody's got one. All right? And most of the time, they stink. I can still remember Bob Jones saying one time, he was saying, how come this prophet got that and that prophet got that? And God, you didn't tell me. He says, because you already had an opinion. I couldn't get past your opinion. That's true of all of us. If it's true of him, it's true of us, certainly. So sometimes opinions have to be held loosely and say, God, what do you say? Matter of fact, even in the days ahead, if there's an outpouring of God's Spirit upon the church, trust me, there's going to be flaky stuff going on, and there's going to be good stuff going on that you didn't know. Ask, inquire. God is at you before you judge. Or before you form an opinion, ask God, Holy Spirit, is that you? Wisdom will search out the matter, not just have an opinion. And you know, one of the most difficult things for a pastor is having more information than the congregation, and the congregation having an opinion. I always use the same example. Once had a man that the other churches notified me that he should not be in the nursery because he's got a record. And I had people in the church mad at me because I wouldn't let that nice man in the nursery. But you know what? Be mad. I have a responsibility and I'll continue to do it. But know this, that what God calls in a place of responsibility, you're going to stand before Jesus for that, for a higher purpose. So you have to allow that to be taken in consideration. But everybody else in the church could have had an opinion on it. Why is Dennis being so mean to that old man? Huh. Well, you know what? You need to forgive. And you need to also recognize you don't have enough information. And there's things going on that you don't know about all the time. You're responsible in your jurisdiction. When we traveled, we saw four functions that needed to be bombarded to the body of Christ if they're ever going to mature. One, know your jurisdiction. Two, quit adjudicate instead of abdicate. You know how many Christians are quitting all the time? Oh, I quit. It's even in the atmosphere at times. I quit. Almost everyone I've ever seen quit was not God. It was an unresolved attitude of the heart that they could have had fixed. And you can, stinky attitudes will show without discernment, but by and large, quitting is always prefaced by an attitude adjustment. That's necessary. Adjudicate is what you are called to do, to rule and reign as kings and priests in Christ Jesus when he's ruling. Abdicate is the quitting. So it's jurisdiction, adjudication, and real spiritual warfare is not yelling and screaming or based on the volume, although Jennifer's a loud intercessor. I don't want to tell you, the whole house shakes when she intercedes. But it's not in the volume, but real spiritual warfare is displacement. You don't stab a demon and they die. You displace it with greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. And when you displace it in an atmosphere, Jesus is ruling. And he's totally competent to maintain that if you allow him to maintain. Displacement. And the last one is advancement. For whatever reason, people get satisfied with the status quo quickly. And sometimes I see it as a form of hardening of the heart. Unless you continue to challenge yourself to move forward and upward in God, and you start to stagnate in, well, I do this, but I don't do that. Once you start telling me what you don't do, you're already in the beginning of stagnation. God isn't going to make you do something that's contrary to his will, but you, more often than not, are more obstinate than you think. He would really like you to expand, grow, and advance. Occupy, take new territory, do things you didn't even know. You have no idea. In the military, that's why they had boot camp, is to take young men like us that were in our teens and go through boot camp, and you find out you really can do some things that you didn't think you could do. But had there not been a boot camp, you'd have never known. You'd have just quit at a comfortable place. God is looking for a church of conviction, not convenience. And he's gonna stir us up. But the behavior that's coming from the love of God is always redemptive oriented. Even in our churches, I've seen churches that discipline, but they discipline without any plan for restoration. They just discipline. And to just say you're wrong, that's one thing. There's another thing is in the jurisdiction in which you are called to facilitate change and transformation. A redemptive orientation. When you have a redemptive mindset, your discipline is going to be loving and fair, but it's not going to get confused with God is love, but love is not God. That is a major problem in the church. They're tolerating sin and calling it love. No, that's not it. God is love. Love is not God, not at the sacrifice of righteousness. There's too many scriptures that mark those who cause division among you. Do not eat with them. What are those things in there for? Is that a loving God? Certainly is. And does he care about? Was that a loving thing that I did by not letting that old man go in the nursery? Oh, but he was such a nice man. See, that's what we have a tendency to do and cause great harm. I don't know. One of the things when we first started the church, I remember Holly and others used to say that the single ladies felt safe. That's a good thing. I was in a church once where me and my friend were going to support a new pastor, but we were both, I consider both of us strong leaders. And this new pastor that we were trying to support had that love concept. And one of the people on the worship team had a temper tantrum and took scissors and snipped all that. That's illegal, by the way, you know that. They committed a crime. And the pastor said, oh, I can't confront him on that. Me and my friend says, we can't support this man anymore because he's too weak. I can be a strong leader and submit to someone else's authority, but I don't see any authority. And you know what? Those people on the worship team, do you think they felt safe? I wouldn't. Would you? If the pastor wouldn't do nothing about it, I go, what if they slip my tires while I'm in the parking lot? What if they're mad at me for being up here instead of them? And they snip wires. But that's almost, that's an extreme example, but it really happened. I mean, I was there. Biblically literate person, but that's almost the way the shaping of the church is now, and that's almost where the church has to change. Not almost, it does have to change. So Father, we just pray right now that your value system is going to bring those two bottles of wine, holy love, together. And we're going to seek the hidden manna. We're going to seek the hidden wisdom and the hidden riches, those treasures of darkness and the hidden riches of that secret place with you. That hidden place that no matter how evil the world is around me, the evil one touches me not. I want that revelation of the love of God, that he keeps me that safe from trouble in the midst of trouble. So Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, if you're watching by Ustream and you want to make this personal, the next time God gives you a verse of scripture, ask the Lord to bring a scripture to mind if you want to do it now. But quite frankly, I encourage all of you to look at your Bibles, because there was a word that God didn't give it for no reason. If it's a favorite scripture, it's not a coincidence. That favorite scripture is to correct something in you so that life will go well with you. For me, it was that I wouldn't just try to get knowledge, but that I would know him. And it's never changed all these years. That I might know him. That I might display as part of the church to principalities and powers that multifaceted revelation that he shone in my heart through the face of Jesus Christ. And with steadfast devotion to purpose, I have set my face like flint to move forward in that truth. God's written those things on your heart. Look up those favorite verses of scripture and take this process through and cherish it as if it was pure gold. Let God take those favorite scriptures and let them do a work in you. How many have gotten scriptures like, I know the plans that I have for you, plan? Okay, you know what? That's to eradicate your tendency to hopelessness and despair. There is a future and there is a hope, and God's got a plan for it, and you can enter into it. And he is smart enough that no matter how badly you sabotage your life, he can get you back on track. He really is that smart. He can restore the years the locust has eaten. He's really that smart. He's that loving, and he's got that much wisdom. You don't. That's why you quit and give up hope. As you go, I can never fix this. This is a mess. Things have been going on like this too long, for too long. Oh, no. God says, I can fix it. Turn it over to me. Ask for the Lord to bring a scripture. Stay there until you meet the living word in that verse. Don't drink, don't think, feed, don't read. Absorb it, become a divine partaker of the divine nature. And whatever the Lord reveals to you would be written on the tablet of your heart. The outworking will have a redemptive orientation in thought, word, and deed from that time on. You will live it. It will be easier to obey than to not obey it. How many have got a scripture or something that's favorite? You've written it on your Bible at some point in time. I mean, you might have many favorites, but there's something you know he spoke. Why don't we try it with this one right now? Let's just spend a few minutes. Won't hurt. Take that verse. Hold it down in your heart. And just say, I take that verse, whatever it is, and I cherish it. I want to absorb it spiritually. I want to meditate in my heart until I become a partaker of that divine nature. Birth an attitude to change anything that's interfering with it. I receive forgiveness. Birth in me a new attitude. I receive forgiveness for anything in me that has hopelessness attached or is contrary to that scripture. Incubate until there is a new attitude birth. And suddenly, that word that I received, I believe. There's the new attitude. There's the birthing, death, burial, and resurrection. I believe that I've received. People in faith camp used to say that. I believe that I receive. If you do it slow enough, it actually works. If you do it fast, it's just pray after me prayer. Ah, I believe that I receive that scripture. And if you feel his presence, that's a person. That scripture is him. I welcome him to write on the tablet of my heart that truth. My value system is becoming a person. I am a partaker of the divine nature, and I am welcoming him to transform me on the inside. I am welcoming him to take the pen of the Holy Spirit and write it on the tablet of my heart. You know, if you spend days on this, you take that scripture and you apply it again and again for days and weeks at a time, the only thing that will happen is it'll never get erased, but it'll grow deeper like an engram, just like a carving. God's carving it with the finger of the Holy Spirit, writing it on the tablet of your heart until it goes deeper and deeper and deeper. I know you weren't taught this, boy, in Sunday school, were you? You were taught to pray after me and say it out loud, right? Read it and say it. Read it and confess it. Read it and confess it. But you could short circuit the reality of the experience, couldn't you? So, Father, we just thank you that you began a good work in us. You're going to continue that good work. And the inworking and the outworking, I want to welcome the process. I want to welcome that the initial encounter has a subsequent relationship to it. And I want to honor you in every step of that relationship. That is not a technique or a method. That is a relationship. And from the initial encounter to the subsequent relationship, we're going to be a transfigured fullness people, because in reality, we've got almost two camps in the church. We have the camp that wants the encounter. Bam, bam, bam. They always want the encounter and then live in the flesh the rest of the time. Look for an encounter and then live in the flesh. Look for an encounter, live in the flesh. Then you've got the other camp that everything's a process, even without the Holy Spirit. And they're beating themselves up and living in condemnation. No. This is a merging of the encounter with the subsequent relationship that follows a real relationship. From the new birth, as you received him, so walk in him. Identical to your salvation experience is your walk or your sanctification experience. Seal this word by the power of the Holy Spirit this day. Write it on tablets of people's hearts. Cause them to have a new inciting to action, to awaken those good things that you placed in them, and cause them to resurface and cause them to be on fire for the indwelling word to be made richer and fuller. Write it on the tablets of their heart. Amen. Amen.
You've been listening to Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark of Full Stature Ministries at forgive123.com. Full Stature Ministries reserve all copyright protections under applicable law. Our copyright policy is available at our website, forgive123.com. For more information about Full Stature Ministries and additional life-transforming materials, please visit forgive123.com.